Well, hello, everybody. Good morning, church. There you go. Some of you are awake. Good morning, church. Oh, yes. It's so good to have you in the house of the Lord. My name is Christian, and if I do not know you, I have the privilege of serving as the pastor for Harvest in Español, and I also get to teach at Harvest Christian Academy. We started classes first weekend. We're still standing, so this is fantastic. And it's so good to have, yes, to all teachers, all students, we're back. So it's so good to have you. If I haven't met you yet, I would love to meet you out there in the lobby. And if you're from home, we would love for you to use our Connect card to just let us know how we can serve you. Buenos días a todos ustedes. Mi nombre es Cristian. Tengo el privilegio de servir como el pastor de Harvest en español. Esta mañana estamos aquí juntos. Amén. Bendiciones. Y estamos contentos de que esté aquí en la casa del Señor. Si podemos conocerle después del servicio, vamos a estar ahí afuera para conocerle y decirle lo que Dios está haciendo en medio de nuestra comunidad. Si usted está ya de casa, puede utilizar el check-in para decirnos que está aquí esta mañana. We are going to have a seminar on September 21st from 9 to 12. It's called the Bible and the End of Life Seminar. And what is going to help us is gain a biblical perspective that you need for making serious medical decisions. And it's going to be a great opportunity to know how we can honor the Lord even in those ways. If you would like to know more about it, you can go to harvestbible.org. We always love to pray for other churches like us are taking the gospel to their context, to their local context. So today we are praying for High Point Church in Naperville and their pastor Craig Steiner. So would you please join me in prayer for them? Lord, we are so thankful that we can be in your house. We are so thankful that we can take this time to be renewed, to get strength from being together, for being ministered through music, through your word, Lord. And God, we pray today for High Point Church and what they are doing in their local context. May you bless their efforts to reach out their community in the name of Jesus. We pray for this time that it will be a blessing to us and an encouragement. It is in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. We are so thankful for what the Lord is doing in our church through Harvest Young Adults. So please turn your attention to the screens.
Welcome to Harvest Young Adults, otherwise known as HYA. HYA is a place for anyone who considers himself a young adult to come and encounter God, grow deeper roots in their faith, and find community. Well, maybe not anyone. We invite you to use discretion. And it all starts here at our monthly HYA night, where a ton of young adults gather for a night of food, worship, teaching, and connection. We played lots of games. What's your favorite, Lewis?
Basketball. Dang it.
We go out on fun excursions and trips. Most importantly, we spend time in God's Word, learning and growing together. But it's not just about the big events. Every week, HYA hosts community groups where young adults from each campus meet at a leader's house, and this is where things really get good. Here we get to know each other as friends. We talk about things we learned in the sermon that weekend and how it applies to the way we live. We talk about what's going on in each other's lives, take time to pray for each other, and share life together as a group of fellow believers. Ultimately, HYA makes up the next generation of our church. And the ministry provides opportunities to put your spiritual gifts to use. From HYA, we can branch out and serve together in other ministries, help out in our communities, and grow the church as a whole, helping to share the word of God everywhere. So if you're a young adult, come on by. And even if you aren't, let's all take a moment to appreciate and encourage the amazing work that God is doing through this ministry in our church.
Amen. So we're so thankful for what the Lord is doing at HYA. If you want to know more about it, go to harvestbible.org. I'm going to invite you this morning to stand up. We're going to read God's word to begin our time. Póngase de pie, vamos a leer la palabra del Señor esta mañana. We're reading from Isaiah. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary. Amen to that. He increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. Let's worship the Lord this morning, church.
Your freedom. could I express all my gratitude? I could sing these songs as I often do. Every song was stand, and you never do. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not, I'm nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah. I've got one response, I've got just one move, with my arms stretched wide, I will worship you. Lift up your soul. Oh, you got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Oh, come on, church. We sing, come on. Oh, come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me. Lift up your soul. You've got a
walked in here with today. Maybe
you're running on empty. Maybe your heart is full. Maybe you're somewhere in between. But our heart's response in worship is to give him everything. Maybe it's little, maybe it's a lot. But even in this moment, I just want us to take a moment to give him everything. It says in Psalm 73, it says, my heart and my flesh may fail, but God is the strength and my portion forever. We can rely on him today. Maybe if you're running on empty, even if we're full today, we still rely on him because he's the author and perfecter of our faith. So if you're comfortable, can you lift up your hands as we sing this one more time? So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. Cause all that I have is a hallelujah. And I know it's not, I've nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah,
your breath in our lungs, so high and lifted up. He is worthy of our praise and adoration. There is no one like him. It is a joy to be in the house of the Lord together. Amen? Amen. Well, before we get started into the teaching, I'd love for you to say hi to someone around you.
Great to see you. How are you? Yeah? Well, yeah, it's good to have you. Listen, before we study God's word together, I just need to let you know that part of our worship as a church is, of course, we give back to the Lord a portion of what it is that he's given to us. Everything we own belongs to the Lord. Amen? It's not ours. We're just stewards of it, and so we look after it, and it's very kind of the Lord to give us enough so that we can look after ourselves and have fun doing all sorts of things. He gives that as a gift to us, but also we're responsible to make sure that we take care of his people. And so part of that is giving to the local church. And so we have lots of different ways you can do that. There's little blue boxes in the back. You can give online. You can do a QR, this QR code if you like doing the QR code type things. I need to let you know that when I'm talking like this, I'm addressing people who are part of Harvest Bible Chapel, not those of you who are visitors with us, or as I would like to call you, first-time attenders, because you'll be back, I promise. For you, it's gift enough for you to be with us. We're so happy that you're here. Thanks so much for being here, and it's awesome that you get to join us in what we're doing. So your presence is gift enough. For the rest of us, we want to commit ourselves to the Lord and to giving back to him. So I want to pray for that. And I also want to pray for our time together as we study God's word. So let's do that together. Lord, I'm thankful for the enormous blessings that you have given us in our lives. We don't really reflect on it enough. But when we do, and we look around at the life you've given us, and we take maybe a 30,000-foot view, we realize that you've blessed us beyond measure. I'm thinking even today about there are brothers and sisters in Christ in places around the world today, Father, who are sitting in seats without backs on the chairs, and they walked miles to get to church this morning, and they're expectantly waiting for the word of God to be proclaimed, and we get to sit in an air conditioning room, and we get to have comfortable chairs, and we get to have TVs, and all sorts of cool trinkets, Father, and phones and all these things. And these are gifts from you to us. Father, we are the richest people in the history of the world. And I pray, Father, that we would not take that for granted, but would view it as a not only a blessing, but as a responsibility to make sure, Father, that those who don't have are people who can have. And I'm thankful for the ministries like Hope Center here. And I'm also thankful for the ministries of some of our benevolence and all the different ways that we share what we have with one another. I pray that you find us deeply generous people. I also, Father, want to ask you for your help. You know, we can build a house, but if we build it without you, we labor in vain. And I pray, Father, that the house that we're about to build in terms of this sermon, in terms of what we're going to study today, Father, would be built with not just your hand, but your spirit moving very freely among us and opening our eyes to see and ears to hear what it is that you have for us. Would you bless us richly with this magnificent passage of Scripture? Would it have the impact on us that it was intended to have on its original audience, Father? So find me faithful, I pray, in trying to communicate the best I can. I pray, Lord, that you would do your work among us and that you'd produce the kind of lives, not just be hearers of the word, but doers, so that you produce the kind of lives that reflect you in some way. So bless us today. In Jesus' name, amen. I rode my bike to Chicago yesterday. I live in Barrington, Illinois, and I rode to Chicago, Illinois, on my bicycle. And yes, thank you. You didn't do it, did you? Like, none of you, I didn't see any of you along the way. Now, I tell you that, and some of you are like, well, that's kind of impressive. It's an e-bike, but let's not quibble about how the bike moves. I had a heart condition, and I needed to keep my heart rate into a more reasonable level, and my normal bike keeps my heart rate way high, and so this one actually hits the right marks according to my cardiologist, and so it's really great that I'm able to do this. But I've been able to travel further and faster than I've ever been able to before. Now, I'm not a salesperson for electric bikes, but no one's paying me to say this, although I would be open to that possibility. But nobody's saying, no one's paying me to say this, but you got to get you an e-bike. I'm not kidding. They are ridiculous how much fun they are. Mostly, if you're like me and you spend a good long time riding a bike in your life, but have always been the slowest person in the group, that the person that everybody has to wait for and stuff, because I just, you know, gravity affects this a lot. And so it's hard for me to go the speed of all these really skinny, you know, capable guys on their bikes. And so I'm always the one in the behind, and they'll be riding next to me, and I'll be like, and they'll be like talking about, you know, theoretical physics or things like that. And I just can't contribute to the conversation because I'm breathing so hard. Well, how the turntables. I am now the one who goes along with them, and they're breathing hard, and I'm like, I don't know what's so hard, dude. This is a really easy ride. I don't understand. In fact, let's pick it up a notch, and you know, you start going. One of my favorite things to do on my e-bike actually is to pass the guys and the guys who wear all the Lycra. I know that that's for aerodynamics, but it's never really mattered that much for me. There was a period where I did wear the Lycra shorts and alone and wore a shirt on top of it, and then I realized, I don't think that's helping anybody in the community, so I wear a pair of shorts on top of it now, and I don't look the part, right? I ride past these, but one of my favorite things to do is to come up behind one of these guys who's just cooking, right? He's there, he rides every morning, and just fly past him. And I usually, right while I'm going by him, I'll say, on your left. And then he's like, as I said many times in other settings, he's like, how can something that fat go that fast? And so sometimes they try to keep up with you because they get embarrassed by the fact that you're doing, because they didn't get a good enough look at the bike to realize it was an e-bike. So they're like, I'm going to keep up with this guy. And so they try, and I playfully sometimes slow down to, you know, for them to catch up, and then I go really fast, and it's fantastic. I absolutely, absolutely love it. One of the things I think about while I'm on my bike, though, is how I would love. I'm a preacher, right? So I think about stuff that's theological and spiritual when I'm experiencing stuff like this. And one of the things I think about is, I would love for my life as a Christian to be like this. Do you know? Not riding into the wind, but riding with the wind. Like, because I know that the Bible says that I'm indwelt by the Spirit as a Christian. And there are other passages, in fact, that talk about how we can mount up with wings like eagles and run and not grow weary, walk and not be faint. And I would love to experience that. That passage, in fact, is one that I was reading this week. It's Isaiah 40. He gives power to the faint. To him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youth shall faint and be weary. Even young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They'll ride an e-bike. They'll mount up with wings like eagles. They'll run and not be weary, shall walk and not be faint. They'll mount up on wings like eagles. The idea is that they'll be able to keep doing this. Like eagles up there, and they can just soar forever. To walk and not be faint is something they can just keep doing without stopping. I feel a lot of times in my Christian life like I'm just plain tired. I'm exhausted. Following Jesus, yes, is hard, and it's something that I want to do, and I'd love to do, and yet it wears me out. Because things in my life don't always happen the way that I want them to. I make a plan that we should go right, and then it ends up going left, and then I get frustrated with the Lord, and I question his character and wonder why it is that he's doing things, and I think to myself, why have you forgotten about me? Don't you care about my particular situation? All sorts of horrible things befall me, and I don't feel, honestly, I do not feel like I'm up on the, you know, on the clouds with the wind under my wings, soaring like I could keep going all the time. I feel like I just want a nap. And yet, passages like this exist. And they promise a kind of life that I don't always experience. So what my question is, how do you get that? In this fallen world where everything doesn't seem to go right for me, and that raises all sorts of questions about who God is and the way things function, how do I, in the midst of all of those circumstances, have this life? To use images for that are in the New Testament, how do I walk on top of the waves when Jesus calls and not sink? Because clearly you can do that. How? Well, look, that's actually what I want to try to answer today. And I want to answer it with this passage. This is the end of Isaiah 40. And I want to actually study what precedes it that leads to that kind of conclusion for Isaiah when he writes it. What is it that we need to know? What is it that we need to do in order to experience that kind of soaring like an eagle, riding an e-bike, Christian life? Well, look, in this passage, I think there are five things that he says about God that you and I need to remember, okay? So this passage is about the character of God. There are five things that we need to remember about who God is, because we will often forget that he's actually like this. And so this morning is a reorientation about the real God. My goal here is to scream at the top of my lungs, "Behold your God." And at the end, I think you'll find that your spirit has been lifted to such a degree that you're like, oh, I could soar here. Five things about the character of God. Number one, he's compassionate. God is compassionate. You need to remember that he is compassionate if you want to soar like an eagle. I get that from the beginning of Isaiah 40. So we're going to start here with our five things. Number one, he's compassionate. You get it in the first words, right? Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Now, this phrase, these two words actually are really, really important given the context of the book of Isaiah. Because what he immediately said prior to this in Isaiah 39 is not very comforting for the people, okay? So when you go back to Isaiah 39, just the chapter immediately preceding, so Isaiah 39 verse 5, here's what you get. Isaiah said to Hezekiah. Hezekiah was the king at the time, and Hezekiah had just given a whole bunch of Babylonian visitors, right? An entourage from Babylon who came and said, we'd love to see the kingdom. And Hezekiah was like, yeah, let's show you around. Like if your friends came from outside of Chicago and you were like, oh, wait till you see the Hancock Tower, whatever it's called now, right? Wait till you see, you know, wait till you see the water. Wait till you see Highland Park. Wait till you see all your favorite things. So you're going to take them around to show them the treasures of the city of Chicago and the region of Chicagoland. Well, that's what this guy had done. He had basically said, hey, let me show you the kingdom. In fact, let me show you all the treasures that we have, right, in our treasure room. Let me show you the ark, and let me show you all the amazing stuff that we've got. You kings and leaders of another nation who sometimes is hostile to us. This is not probably a great idea, right? But he's sort of flaunting it. Well, he does. He flaunts it. And then Isaiah says, hey, did you show them all of this stuff? And Hezekiah said, yeah, it was amazing. You should have been there. They were really amazed. They were taking notes the whole time. Isaiah said to Hezekiah, hear the word of the Lord of hosts. Behold, the days are coming when all that is in your house, all the stuff you just showed them, and that which your fathers have stored up till this day, shall be carried to Babylon. The guys who just came, the Babylonians, who when they were taking notes, it was an inventory, dude. And they're going to show up and they're going to take all of it. Nothing shall be left, says the Lord. And some of your own sons, not just the stuff, your own sons who will come from you, whom you will father, shall be taken away. And they shall be eunuchs in the palace of the king of Babylon. That sounds lovely dream for your children, doesn't it? One day you can be a eunuch in the king of another country. When you're the existing king, this is a sign of massive defeat. You're going to go and you're going to serve at the feet of another king. Not very comforting. He's actually foretelling Isaiah that the Babylonian exile. Basically, Babylonians are going to come in. They're going to wipe everybody out. They're going to take the best people. Remember Daniel and those guys? They're going to take the best people. They're going to take them off to their land. And they're going to indoctrinate them there. They're going to decimate basically all of Israel. It's going to feel like the end of everything. So, bad news. But then right on the heels, without even a hesitation, the Lord's like, but, hey, look. Comfort, comfort my people. Those are the next words in the book. But comfort, comfort my people. I know, look, we're going through some woods. In other words, he's saying, there's going to be some woods. Terrible, scary woods, animal sounds. You're going to feel like you're lost and that God's forgotten about you. But I'm telling you that there, eventually you'll get to the tree line. And then on the other side of the tree line, you're going to be comforted. Bad news, and then he jumps right into the good news. Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly. This is a great word, by the way. To speak tenderly is used, that language is used in other places in the Bible to talk about how a man tries to woo his beloved so that she will marry him, right? I don't talk that way very much to my wife now. I've been married 30 years, and after 30 years, when you call for your wife in the house, it's usually, Jeannie! You know? Jeannie! You know, I just yell at the top of my lungs, Jeannie, what are you? Don't worry, she does the same. Jeff! We just yell back and forth in the house. This is what 30 years of marriage does to you. But I didn't always talk to her that way. Okay? If you're looking to marry someone here, if you're in the dating thing, don't yell that way. The way you yell is, Jeannie, honey. And then you get up and you walk up to her and say, oh, hi, Jeannie. Would you like to come and join me downstairs and maybe get me an apple? Right? That's how you do it. You don't say, Jeannie, apple! But that's what God says. God, listen, Isaiah, what I want you to do is I want you to speak tenderly to the people. I want you to speak to them in a reassuring fashion, in a loving fashion, help to remind them that I'm still their God. Even though they're going to have to go through this very difficult moment, justly so, they have turned their back on God. And I am a good father who disciplines his children. And so they're going to go through this difficult moment, but that's not the end goal. The end goal is restitution and restoration and joy. Comfort them with the knowledge of that coming joy. Cry to her that her warfare is ended. Tell her about the meadow that's to come and that her iniquity is pardoned, and she's received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. That's not literal. It's other reasons. It's a full amount for all her sins. It's been enough. What she suffered has been enough. A voice cries in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. In other words, the Lord, I'm going to come. It's not all going to be woods. I'm coming. And when I come, get ready. In fact, get ready even now. Before you go into the woods, get ready for the knowledge that the woods are going to end. In the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain shall be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed. In those days, if you went out and won a victory against your enemy, you would usually bring some article that identified your country as serving this particular God. So for the people of Israel, it was the ark they would bring out, right? Other countries would have different, you know, maybe a statue or a scepter or something that identified that our God is, you know, this particular God. And then you'd win, and on the way back, there would be a victory processional. And this is the language that was used. When our victorious king and our God returns, prepare a way for them. Make every high place low and every low place high so it's even ground and no one's going to stumble. Make a way through the desert. Welcome them. Roll out the red carpet. That's the language. So God's saying, be ready. Welcome me like the nations around. They're going to be, welcome their king because I'm going to come as a victor. The glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. I think this is a remarkable little beginning. Because of that context, though, it's almost like the Lord can't let his people dwell too long on the bad news without giving them the reassurance that there is good news. Which means, of course, that God is compassionate. He's inclined to fits of compassion. He just can't help himself. There's actually a place in the book of Hosea where next week you should come back because we're going to talk about the book of Hosea. And in Hosea chapter 11 where God, the Lord's like, oh, you make me so mad, Israel. And why are you doing this wicked, awful things and turning away from me? And then he just breaks in and says, oh, but I can't stay mad at you. You're such my beloved. That the Lord is like that. And listen, the Lord, our God, understands us in ways that no one else could possibly understand. He knows every thought you have. He knows every inclination of your heart and every dream you've ever had. He's seen every part of your life. The Lord knows. And it's not just that. He doesn't see it from a distance. Do you know that? Like, we have a God who's entered into our suffering. That's what we celebrate every Christmas. Is that he's become one of us. So he doesn't like go, that must be really hard for them down there. I don't really. He entered into it so much so that we have stories in the Bible about Jesus showing up basically at a funeral of a friend. And everybody is devastated by Lazarus' death. And he stands there seeing everyone else weeping and he starts to cry. God cries. This is one of the fundamental ways in which our God, Yahweh, the true God, is not Allah. Allah's distant and our God entered in. And tears flowed when he got well acquainted with the death, with the fact that we have to face this. You cannot pray to our God and say, I wish you knew what it was like to face people who, my loved ones who die. He's like, I stood outside the tomb of my friend. I know what it's like to have tear-stained face. There's all these people on the beach at one point, 5,000. Jesus shows up and says, we need to feed them. The disciples are like, we got no food to feed them with. Send them away. And Jesus, it says, has compassion on them. He knows what it's like to be hungry. He knows what it's like to feel lost, to be without a shepherd in this world, to feel like you've been abandoned. Because the Lord the Father says, you know, On the cross, I'm sorry, Jesus says on the cross, you know, why have you forsaken me? He knows all of those experiences. And so when the Lord, when we pray to the Lord, we're talking to our compassionate God, the one who has deep feeling for us, who can't, he can't let us just sit and dwell in our weakness. There's this wonderful psalm that, there's a wonderful psalm that, I think about from time to time, Psalm 103, it says, as a father shows compassion to his children, so the Lord shows compassion to those who fear him. For he knows our frame. He remembers that we are dust. He knows how much energy you have and don't have. He knows that sometimes you run out of steam. Isn't that an interesting thing? As a father shows compassion on his children, you know, because when you're a dad and you've got your little toddler, you don't walk at your regular pace, right?
If you were better, you'd keep up, kid.
No, you slow down and you go at their pace and you walk that way. And the reason you do that is you know what it's like to be little. You've been in those shoes. When your high schooler just starts high school, or maybe your student goes off to college and they're sorrowful because they miss home, or because they don't know what to do with all of the relationships that are forming around them, and everything seems to be changing, and the tears flow in their eyes, you know what that's like. You've been there. You remember. No matter how old you are and how senile you are, you remember those feelings. And what happens is it causes compassion to arise in your heart so that you listen. That's our God. We have a God who understands us. So if your heart is going to soar like the eagle, if you're going to be able to keep going following Jesus your whole life, you need to know that you don't have a God in heaven who stands at a distance and says, I wish you could do better at this. What you have is a God who's entered in. You have a spirit who's in you. You have Jesus who's with you. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall not fear, for you are with me. He's our compassionate God. He's also, second, a God who's faithful to his word. Always. Verse 6, Isaiah 40. A voice says, cry. And I said, what should I cry? Well, this is what you cry. All flesh is grass. And all its beauty is like the flower of the field. Think of all the beauty of human beings and all the culture and the magnificent things that we create, from buildings to eyeshadow. Its beauty is like the flower of the field. The grass withers. The flower fades when the breath of the Lord blows on it. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers. The flower fades, meaning they don't have any lasting power. They're here for just a second, and then they're gone. All the words that you and I speak in our world today, and all of our leaders, and all of the blustering is just a blip in an eternal radar that God has got. The word of our God, though, will stand forever. This word of our God is a reference to his promises. Basically, if the Lord says something is going to happen, it's going to happen. He has the power to make it happen. He has the will to make it happen. He has the plan that will make it happen. And it doesn't matter who you are. No one's going to stand in his way, because we are but dust. We are mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes away. So because of that, because the word of the Lord lasts forever, he says, go on a high mountain then, O Zion, herald of good news. Lift up your voice with strength. Don't be shy about it when you're declaring the word of the Lord to the people. Don't be like, well, I hope God comes through with it, all this. Here's hoping. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good news. Lift it up. Fear not. Say to the cities of Judah, behold your God. Behold, the Lord comes with might. So when you get through the woods, he's going to be coming. You should make a way for him. But He's going to come with might as a warrior, and his arm rules for him. Behold, his reward is with him and his recompense before him. He's going to come with all the riches that he's won with his battle, and he's coming to lavish them on you. He will tend his flock like a shepherd. You guys notice the shift that took place right there between. He's a warrior coming like Braveheart, you know. His arm, did you see the language? His arm rules for him. That's what happens. My right arm will rule because it will slash you with my mighty sword. His arm rules for him. But you go from this image of this mighty warrior, and he'll also tend his flock like a shepherd. He'll gather the lambs in his arms. He will carry them in his bosom and gently lead those that are with young. Did you see that? This is fascinating. His arm rules for him, and he will gather the lambs in his arms. The same arm that one minute is slaying the enemy is the arm that gathers up the tender animals that are his to comfort them. The image here, when I was reading this, I was like, man, this is like a farmer who, you know, there's wolves that have come in and they are trying to eat all his animals, his chickens and his sheep and all that kind of stuff. And he, you know, bursts front door of his house and he pulls out his shotgun and he's just laying waste. Kaboosh, kaboosh, kaboosh. Right? Don't get in the, if you're a wolf, don't get in the way because you're going to be filled with holes, brother. Kaboosh. But then once the wolf runs off, he goes right up with the same arm that just shot this shotgun, and he gathers the animals up, and he nurses, brings them back. That's our God. Which is actually pretty important. What Isaiah is saying here is that when I tell you that our God is going to come as both a warrior and a shepherd, you can bank on it. You can absolutely 100% bank on it. He's not like you. He's not like me. He's not like flesh and like grass that withers and falls away. He's the word of our Lord stands forever. So when I tell you that our Lord is going to come like that, he's going to come like that. And so the really important thing for you, for me, anybody listening, need to internalize is which kind of arm am I going to experience from the Lord? Am I going to experience the arm of the warrior from the Lord because I have rejected him and I have rebelled against him and his will? Or am I going to experience the arm of comfort from the Lord as he gathers me up? See, the coming of the Lord is good news and bad news. It's good news if you are one of those who are his. It's bad news if you're not. And when I say that to people, it's funny. People are like, well, yeah, you religious types, you just whatever. Those are just religious talk. No, listen to the words again. I'm telling you, the word of our God stands forever. When I tell it to you, this is going to happen. Do you know what kind of track record this God has? When he said to Adam, don't eat of the tree or you will die, he ate of the tree and then he died. When he said to Noah, build the ark because there's going to be rain and everyone might be mocking you, but keep build the ark. The rain came and Noah was saved with his family, but everybody else died. His word came to fruition. When Jesus comes and says, see that temple over there? I'm going to tear it down in three, you know? And they're like, oh, don't be ridiculous. Well, you guys killed him. He rose again. And in 70 AD, the temple was raised. We could do this all day. God makes a promise and it comes true. God makes a promise and it comes true. How can you possibly sit here and think to yourself, well, not this time? Like the one time in the history of the world, it's not gonna come true and you're gonna bank your eternal destiny on that? Man, I gotta be honest, you're like grass. And he's not. His word stands forever, and you don't want to experience the arm of warrior. You want to experience the arm of the shepherd. By the way, it's not that complicated to experience the arm of the shepherd. It basically just means you just say, I give up, Lord. I give up. You are king. I can't do it. Let's be honest. I can't do it. I'm not good at this. I'm not good at life. I'm not good at faith. I'm not good at anything. I think you're real. I think Jesus is real. I think he loves me, and I want to be yours forever. That's it. And you will be. So he is compassionate. He's faithful to us. If you want to mount up as wing, with wings like eagles, you need to know without a shadow of a doubt that what God says about the future is actually going to happen. Third, God is wise. Who's measured the waters in the hollow of his hand? You guys ever, at night, you don't want to get the cup to drink the drink while after you brush your teeth? So you stick the old hand under there. That's you're drinking out of the hollow of your hand. What this says is, you know all the waters on the whole planet, all of those ones that we swim in? And ones that you don't see, 95% of the oceans we've never been around. You know all those waters? When the Lord gathers them up, he's like, man, it's about that big. Who's measured the water in the hollow of his hand and marked off the heavens, so the universe, with a span. A span is the distance between your thumb and your pinky. It's a measuring device. The Lord's like, yeah, when I look at the universe, I'm like, it's about that big. I've said this before. One of my favorite things to actually talk about is just the sheer size of the universe and the comparison of that with the Lord in this passage. And so I've shared this before at several places. I'll do it again. If we could get a plane that goes light speed, here's how long it would take you to get to different places around our known universe. If you wanted to get to the moon, it would take you 1.2 seconds. Mars, 4 minutes. The sun, 8.4 minutes. Jupiter, 35 minutes. Pluto, 5.4 hours. Alpha Centauri, which is the closest star system to our solar system. Still within the Milky Way galaxy, but it's the closest star system. It would take you 4 years to get there. If you want to go to the center of the Milky Way galaxy, right? Like we go to the center of the U.S. in Kansas and go, hey, and then you're like, it's boring. You want to go to the center of the Milky Way galaxy? 38,000 years. If you want to go to the Andromeda galaxy, which is the next galaxy from ours, okay? It'll take you 2.2 million years going light speed. And that is the next galaxy over. You do know that there's billions of galaxies, yeah? No? We take pictures of them with the Hubble Space Telescope. And there's so many of them. And the Lord's like, yeah, that big. Who's measured the waters? Who's marked off the heavens with a span and enclosed the dust of the earth in a measure and weighed the mountains in scales and the hills in a balance? Who's measured the Spirit of the Lord? Or what man shows him his counsel? This is them saying, like, who can give God advice on how to do stuff? Who has knowledge or a vantage point above God's where he can say to God, actually, Lord, you were wrong. We should go that way. Just think about that for a minute. We'll go for a hike afterwards. I'm going to lead the hike, so it won't be long. So we're going to go out into the woods. We're going to get lost because I'm leading a hike. And at some point, we're going to be like, okay, we need to figure out how we're going. And there'll be people saying, we need to go that way. And one of us, okay, it'll be me. I volunteer. I'm going to climb a tree. And I'm going to go to the top of the tree. And I'm going to look out the top of this tree. And I'm going to see the way we can go. Because on the ground, you have a vantage point that's limited in terms of what it can see. But when I get up on the tree, I have more knowledge. I have more information that I'm able to make a decision with. I can see above it all. And I can say, well, actually, you want to go that way. We should go that way because it leads out to the river or whatever. The question that he's asking is, okay, who has a higher vantage point than the Lord?
Who's able to climb a tree? And what tree exists that's somehow above God and where it is that he can see things so that you can actually inform him, oh, silly God, you should have done it that way instead of this way. Whom did he consult? And who made him understand? Who taught him the path of justice and taught him knowledge? Who comes up to God and says, actually, Lord, the way that I think that you should do this particular thing is a more just way than the way you're choosing. I have more knowledge than you, Lord. I can show you the way of understanding. Who has that? And the answer is nobody does, because God is infinitely wise. Have you ever met people, though, maybe you and I sometimes do this? I mean, we do it, where we're like, I don't really agree with what the Lord said there. I don't really like what the scriptures have to teach about that thing. I don't like what this says about sexual ethics. I don't like about what it says about my money. I don't like what it says about Jesus. I don't like, because they all threaten my independence. So, you know, there's a lot of problems, morally speaking, with the Bible. Have you ever heard that? And my response, I always want to say, is what tree are you on? Wait, like, what is your point of view that allows you to say to the almighty, infinite God, you should have consulted me, man. Because there are people in the history of the world who have said, I got a problem with what you done here, God. One of them's name's Job. And Job, he had a case to make. His kids died in a massive accident. He lost everything he had in one moment. And his friends show up and are like, you must have done something wrong, Job. And Job's like, I didn't do anything wrong. If anyone's done anything wrong here, it's the Lord. And if I could have a moment to speak with him, I'd hold him to account. He's not done right. I'm on a tree above it. I'm going to hold God to account for the direction he's taken my life. And then the Lord obliges. It's like, okay, let's have that conversation. And he shows up in Job 38. He says, the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Who is this that's throwing shade over what I've done and made what decisions I've made with ignorance? Like, do you really realize who you are and how limited you are compared to me? Like, the distance isn't just from a forest floor to the top of the tree. It's like from way, way down there to infinite. So dress for action like a man, Job. Can you imagine when he raises this question? Job's like, well, it's not me. I didn't raise any questions at all, you know. Dress for action like a man. I'll question you and you make it known to me. I mean, because you're a smart dude. You have the vantage point. Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me if you have understanding. Who determined its measure me? And you love the sarcasm. Surely you know. Of course you don't know, Job. Look, if you and I want to soar on wings like eagles, we really need to remember to stay in our lane. We really need to remember that there are some things that are too wonderful for us to know. That the Lord, in his wisdom, has orchestrated his world in a way that is magnificent and beautiful, and our job is not to fight it. Our job is to accept it. You can have 1,000 questions. You can raise them to the Lord. But at the end of the day, we say, our Lord is wise. Infinitely wiser. And when you do, you will find that the wind starts to blow under your wings. And all the fighting, it feels like you've dropped a lot of weight. It's like someone put a motor in your bike. He's compassionate. He's true to his word. He's wise. He's sovereign, which is really what this passage is about. Okay, follow me with this line. This is some really good stuff. Behold. This is a word that means, let's just have a look at it. The nations are like a drop from a bucket. and are accounted as dust on the scale. You've seen LeBron James before the beginning of his games. You probably, Michael Jordan did it first, and LeBron copied. It's not the first time he's done that. Anyway, so he takes the dust, and he claps his hands together, and it flies in the air. That's what he's saying, that the nations, all of the nations, are counted as dust on the scales. Behold, he takes up the coastlines, right? So all of the beaches of the world, like fine dust, he throws in the air. That's how significant they are. Lebanon, which was known for its massive forests. Like if you wanted to get the very best wood and you wanted to offer it to the Lord, you know, make a fire and offer the best animals, you go to Lebanon. Lebanon wouldn't suffice for fuel, nor is beasts enough for a burnt offering. You could sacrifice all of them and they don't even remotely come close to the glory of God. All the nations are as nothing before him. They're accounted to him as less than nothing and emptiness. All the nations are empty compared to the Lord. To whom then will you liken God? Or what likeness compare with him? Do you guys notice that there's an exclamation point here? An idol. It's not a question. It's like an idol. It's sarcasm. Ooh, I know. I know what we could compare God with. An idol. You know, the little ones that we made in our wood shop? That'll do it. We should put all our trust in one of those little idols. A craftsman casts it, and a goldsmith overlays it with gold and casts it with silver chains. This is expensive stuff, silver chains and gold. So you're making this thing, and it's going to be really beautiful. He who is too impoverished for an offering chooses wood that won't rot. So this guy who's got no money is spending all the money he has to create this magnificent little sculpture. He seeks out a skillful craftsman, right? The best guy around who costs more than anyone else to set up an idol that will not move. So after you've spent all your money chasing that thing that you think is going to serve all your goals, what you've got in the end is nothing. You've got a thing that doesn't move. Congratulations. It seems to me that you might consider instead worshiping a God who does move. Do you not know? Do you not hear? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the world? Guys, this has been the way it's always been. It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers. You guys ever been scared of a grasshopper? Ever in your whole life? Right? No. Yes? Because if you have, shame on you. Right? I mean, you're walking in the darkness of the night, and you hear something, and out of the bushes jumps a grasshopper. Don't run! No, you're like, ooh, pull the legs off of that one. That's what you, oh, come on, right? Every boy in the room's like, yeah, I've done that. A lot of times, I've done that. Nobody tells scary stories around the campfire. Once upon a time, there was a mighty, mighty grasshopper. The inhabitants of the world are like grasshoppers. He's the one who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent. Remember how big the universe is? It's like a tent to him. Like when you throw the sheet on top of your bed. That's what the Lord is. Oh, let me take the whole universe and just throw it as a sheet to cover everything. Spreads them like a tent to dwell in, who brings princes to nothing and makes the rulers of the earth as emptiness. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root on the earth when he blows on them and they wither and the tempest carries them off like stubble. The most important, powerful people in the history of the world, God's just like, whoo, gone. The best part of this passage, in my opinion, actually, is that when it finishes right here. To whom then will you compare me, that I should be like him, says the Holy One. Lift up your eyes on high and see who created these. These he's referring to are the stars and the heavenly bodies, which people in those days believed were they believed that they were deities. Like the moon and the sun and the planets and the stars were all thought to be deities. And he's saying, okay, look up to the heavens. Look at all of the stars in the sky. Who created these heavenly bodies? Who created these gods? And the answer for most people is, well, nobody created them. They're their own independent gods, and they can do whatever they want. And our responsibility is to worship them. But he's saying, he who brings out their host by number. The Lord, Yahweh, has numbered the other so-called gods, right? Hey, Jupiter, you're number four. When I call your name, four, you come out, you stand in front of me. That's exact calling them all by name. Four! He's like a military commander who's standing there. Roll call, four. And Jupiter, sir, yes, sir. By the greatness of his might, and because he's strong in power, not one is missing. Jupiter didn't decide, you know what, I'm going to stand over against this god. I'm going to run away and go AWOL. No. He orders around the gods of the universe. You guys see how this whole thing has gone? He went from the inhabitants are like grasshoppers, and the princes are like nothing, and the gods are nothing. We're covering the whole gamut of all moral beings in the universe, and none of them hold a candle to the sovereign God. None of them can do anything without him. He sits enthroned above the circle of the earth. Those who oppose him have no hope and their plans working out. You know what that means for people like us, right? Stop worrying. Right? Why are you worried? Well, I have so many needs. Yeah, the Lord knows you have the needs, right? He knows what you need. Jesus came along and he was like, well, don't worry about what you eat and what you're gonna wear. And look at the sparrows. He takes care of them. He orders around the heavenly bodies. He accomplishes all things. And he's inclined toward you as your compassionate God. Like, you have a father who can accomplish anything he wants and will accomplish what he promises for you. What in the world are we worried about? Why are we so worried about, like, elections? Seriously, the nations and the princes are accounted as nothing. You do realize that Mao Zedong is dead and gone. Stalin, gone. Alexander the Great, some of you are like, who? Right. Napoleon, wasn't he the little French guy? Yes. Who conquered all of Europe, that little French guy. Hitler's gone. Franklin Delano Roosevelt's gone. Winston Churchill's gone. Gone, 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 gone. And our Lord remains. So, you and I, we get, oh no, it's the most important election of history. Come on. It's important. Vote. Don't hear me wrong. Vote. Care. Passion. And when it's over, God's on his throne. So don't worry. So look, if you believe God is sovereign, it will free you from a kind of worry that'll feel like wind coming up under those wings. So look, let me finish with this last one, which puts it all together. Okay? You need to believe that he's a God worth waiting for, fifth. That he's compassionate, he'll keep his word, that he's wise and he's sovereign, and this God is worth waiting for. Look, why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord? Have you ever felt that? You're facing your own life and you're saying, God, I don't understand why these things are happening. It feels actually like you've turned your back and gone another direction, or that you're off fishing somewhere. My way is hidden from you. I'm following you, but it doesn't, where are you? My right is disregarded by my God. But have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God. He's the creator of the ends of the earth. He doesn't faint. or grow weary. His understanding, his wisdom's unsearchable. He gives power to the faint. And to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youths shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they who what? Wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They'll mount up with wings like eagles. They'll run and not be weary and walk and not be faint. Those who wait on the Lord. That is not a passive thing to do. The biggest question in this whole thing is, okay, I see God. I see he's promised to come and deliver and bring all of his recompense and all of these things. And I know in this present moment we're in the woods. But there's a moment beyond it where he's going to arrive and it's all going to make sense. So in the meantime, what am I supposed to do? I'm supposed to wait or just sit on my hands? No, it's not passive. Because you know how to wait. I'll finish with this. You know how to wait. I know how to wait. For a long-expected guest. When my wife and I were falling in love, it really happened mostly over a summer when I was working at a Christian camp and she was across the state of Washington 6 hours away, and I would drive every week, every weekend, and I'd go and visit her. I only had one day off, so I would drive for 6 hours. I'd stay there for like 9 hours, and I'd come back for six. Right? And I'd start work again. Every weekend I went and did this. Everyone. Except for the one where she came to me. I want you, once she did this, right? Okay. But I remember that day that she was coming and how excited I was. Like she'd said, oh, I'm going to be there around this particular time. It was days before cell phones. So, you make yourself busy with important stuff. I had to do stuff for work, and I was trying to fix stuff. I was fixing stuff at a waterfront, and it was disgusting. The water was gross. The kids are a mess. I'm down there fixing all sorts of stuff. But every few minutes, I get absorbed in this thing. But every few minutes, I would remember, Jeannie's coming, right? And I'd start to smile. And then I'd try something else for a little while and then maybe have lunch and, oh yeah, she's coming. She's coming soon, right? You start to smell. Then your mind, you start to dwell on when she comes, right? We're going to do all this stuff. This is going to be, I have these plans. We're going to have so much fun. But it wasn't just the stuff we were going to do together. It was just her. It was the fact that she was going to be there. And I was like, oh, she's so pretty. And she smells so good. And she's such a, her character is so rich and I think she's just magnificent. I just want to be around her. It's going to be so great. And I remember when she finally showed up, I felt like it had to wait forever. She was late. It's a signal of things to come. So she's late. And when she came, I remember seeing her car pull into the driveway. I was doing something, and I remember I dropped it. It didn't matter anymore. Running up there, hello, hi, blonde, gorgeous, give us a love. You know how to wait for something really special. It's always on your mind. And when it's not for a little while, you try to remember again that it's coming. You know the Lord is going to, he's coming. He said he would. So when he's coming. And yeah, we're busy doing all sorts of stuff. Some of the stuff is really irritating. It's like cleaning a waterfront. It's disgusting. Some of the stuff we get irritated by. But the thing that gives you hope in the midst of all of that difficulty while you're moving the stuff around or maybe, you know, trying to figure out how to make this thing work, in the middle of it, you think to yourself, it's not always going to be like this. She's going to come, and I'm not going to do this anymore, right? And she's going to come, and I'm going to be with her. And you start to smile. Even though your hands are still moving, you're smiling and thinking, yes. Yes, and the things we'll do, and the joy we'll have looking at our Savior's face, and his beauty, and his majesty. This God will be ours, and we will be his forever and ever and ever. And this life right here, this little small piece of history will not matter. We won't even remember sometimes, I don't think, who was the president on a particular day. I just don't think we will. Because we're so enamored with him. And he's coming. He's coming soon. And he will be here, and it will all make sense. So listen, one day, those of you who are in Christ, you and I are going to be in that place, and we're going to pass each other. We are. You and I are going to pass each other, and I'm going to walk by, and I'm going to look you in the eye, and you know what I'm going to say to you? I told you so. Let me pray for us. Lord, I'm thankful for our King. Pastor's job is not actually that complicated, Father. It's just to point people to Jesus and ultimately the glory that he brings and the hope that he brings, so that even though we're in the midst of the waves and the wind, Father, we're able to walk. Father, would you take your character, would you blow it into our hearts, and would you help the wind to rise up underneath our wings so that we would fly with you today? I pray, Father, there's not a single person who would leave church today, not anybody who's heard me, who will not be enraptured by the glory of God. And I pray, Lord, that it would not be something that just we start thinking about, something else midday, but I pray that, Spirit, you would come and you'd remind us over and over and over again of who we are in Christ, of what he's promised, and what he will deliver. Help us to mount up on wings like eagles and not be faint till he comes. And come, Lord Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Amen. We're not done, church. We're not done yet, church. We are going to actually take the opportunity to be reminded of that God who is worth waiting for and his love for us by sharing communion. We are going to be reminded that he gives us the strength to press on, to continue to wait. That he has given us everything that we need in order to persevere every single day. Iglesia, vamos a compartir esta mañana la Santa Cena juntos. Vamos a ser recordados que Dios nos ha dado todo lo que necesitamos para seguir adelante, para perseverar en lo que Dios ha hecho por nosotros. So the ushers are going to come and they are going to pass the elements. We're going to sing a song. This is a family meal, so if you are not, if the Lord Jesus is not your Lord and Savior, you can let those elements pass. But as they go, may you just be reminded that we would love for you to know who he is. And we would love to talk to you about it. We're going to sing. I'll come back. We're going to read in English and Spanish. And then we'll take the elements together. Vamos a pasar los elementos de la Santa Cena. Vamos a leer en inglés y en español. Y luego vamos a tomarlo juntos como familia.
It's always your kindness, Lord. It's always your kindness, Lord, that leads to repentance and the healing I've witnessed. It's always your kindness, Lord. It's only your mercy, Lord. It's only your mercy, Lord. You know where I wander, but you run like a father. It's only your mercy, Lord. And I will give you the weight of my worship. You can have what's dear. It's only your power, Lord. It's only your power, Lord. One touch of your garment, I'm changed in a moment. It's only your power, Lord. And I will give you the
We're going to read from Matthew chapter 26. Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body." Mientras comían, Jesús tomó pan y lo bendijo, luego lo partió y se lo dio a sus discípulos, diciéndoles, "Tomen y comen, esto es mi cuerpo." Let's take it together. He took a cup. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." Después tomó una copa, dio gracias y se la dio a ellos, diciéndoles, "Beban de ella todos ustedes. Esto es mi sangre del pacto que es derramada por muchos para el perdón de pecados." Let's take it together. I'm going to ask you to stand up and let's sing together to the Lord.
It's only your victory. Yes, Jesus, your victory. Because heaven's wide open through your body broken. It's only
day to be reminded who the Lord is. Amen? Because there are many times when we tend to forget that. We forget who the Lord is and we need to be reminded. And the reminder for you today is He is who He says He is. And we need to believe that. And we need to believe it every single day. And we need to be reminded of that. Tenemos que recordar que el Señor es quien Él dice que es. Y cada día debemos regresar a eso, a recordar quién es el Señor en nuestras vidas. Let me remind you that today there's a leadership huddle. It's going to happen at Cornerstone, so make sure that you get there, okay? If you need prayer, we would love to pray for you, so come up to the front. We would love to meet you out there in the lobby. But as you go, reminded of who He says that He is. It's awesome, and this is why we remind you this every single time, because it helps us as we go through each day. Like we say in Harvest en Español, son amados. Don't forget this. You are loved. Have a great week. Mm-hmm.